Jesus, thank you. Lord, thank you for time to come together as a community, time of reflection, time of praise, time of worship. And Lord, I just pray this morning that you would invite us to just be present here. So often we come with so many parts of our week in tow, and Lord, we don't check ourselves to the door, but we bring all of who we are to you. And so, Lord, I ask this morning that you would meet us in those places. Lord, as we talk about who you are and whose we are, that we would remember the good news of the gospel again. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for the ways that you love us. Thank you for the ways that you meet us. I pray this morning that you would give us ears to hear and eyes to see what you're calling us to. And Lord, for me, I pray that it wouldn't be my words, but your words, and that above all else, you would get glory in this place. Lord, we love you. We praise you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Jürgen was born into a non-religious German family in 1926. And Jürgen wrote later on in a journal about how he remembered in early days his family usually would garden on Sunday mornings. They wouldn't go to church. It wasn't part of their regular routine. But he did find himself at church right before his teenage years for confirmation classes. And he said that those confirmation classes made him feel like God was ridiculous. Because what his confirmation classes were about was primarily how God was some sort of Aryan person leading the German people forward. See, Jürgen grew up near Hamburg in Nazi Germany. Said he remembered the stories being told about Jesus or the moments that he had in the church being tainted by these pictures of God. And at 16 years old, he was drafted into the Nazi army, and he was given a post manning an aircraft or an anti-aircraft flak gun with his friend Gerhard Schopper. And at first, it didn't seem so bad. He found himself looking up at the dark stars at night, learning the different constellations around. And that was until, though, July of 1943, when the bombing started. British planes started bombing Hamburg in an operation called Operation Gomorrah, where they sought to level the city as an act of deterrence against the rest of the war, and actually as a response to the bombing of London. This is actually a picture of downtown Hamburg during the bombing. They said that it was so hot during the bombings that all of the air was sucked out of the buildings. And it sounded like, as one person described, all of the keys on a church organ being played at once in the city. 40,000 people were killed. Jürgen found himself floating in the lake on what was left of his platform, his friend Gerhard killed. And he said, that was the first time that I prayed. And I cried out, where are you, God? And who are you? Good morning. It's good to be with you all today. It's interesting. The journey of life is not often an easy one or even a linear one. Our life is filled with both mountaintop moments and low valleys. It's filled with joy and sorrow. It's filled with contentedness and consuming heartbreak. See, life is complicated, and all of us will have ups and downs. And it's interesting because the peaks of life, those moments of fullness and joy, are the times that we can easily see the work of God and celebrate in that season. But the question really is, how will we respond in the hard seasons and the valleys that we have to walk through? And if we're honest with ourselves, we've all probably cried out the prayer of Jürgen at some point in our life, where are you, God? And who are you? And it's interesting because that question isn't just about God, but also a question about us. See, how we view ourselves is directly influenced by how we view God. In fact, the two are inseparable. Or as A.W. Tozier once put it, what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. And this is true, especially when the road gets bumpy. Our difficult times in life don't just shake our view of ourselves, but also our view of God. And as we're on the journey of life, difficulty is unavoidable. We find ourselves crying out and asking the same questions, wondering, where are you, God? Who are you? And who am I? Well, today we continue on in our series in the Psalms of Ascent, the road trip songs of Israel. And as we do so, the psalmist and the liturgy invite us to reflect on God amid the hard situations of life. So if you have your Bibles, open up to Psalm 123. We'll jump into it in a second. But if you haven't been here, let me catch you up so far on where we have been. This summer, we've been studying the Psalms of Ascent together. The Psalms of Ascent were a series of psalms, a sung liturgy that the people of Israel sung specifically as they headed towards Jerusalem for the three holy feasts of the year. And they would sing these songs the entire journey there. In fact, they were a liturgy that was meant to be sung to help guide their hearts home. And we all know this idea of home. In fact, the Psalms of Ascent are a poetry that invite us to reflect on this idea. The place that we feel most at ease, the people that we feel most comfortable with, the space where everybody knows your name, as Cheers once put it. But the Psalms of Ascent start to help us see where home really is. See, we live in a world that is telling us that our home is based on accomplishments or popularity or built identities, but the psalmist reminds us that our home is only found in God. Or as St. Augustine once put it, you have made us and drawn us to yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. See, the Psalms of Ascent invite us to be pilgrims, people who spend our lives on a holy journey. See, we're people that are growing as we go down the road of life, experiencing the world around us and remembering God. That we're people that follow after the way of Jesus, realizing that the world is not our home, but rather we set out for our restless hearts to find their home in God. Or as Eugene Peterson puts it, they are songs of transition, brief hymns that provide courage, support, and inner direction for getting us to where God is leading us in Jesus Christ. We've started out in the first few weeks by setting up the journey home. We started in Psalm 120, which starts with the moment that we realize that there's an actual journey to be made in the first place. That to begin our pilgrimage, we have to start by realizing that we need the journey and that the world around us isn't our home. Micah, a few weeks ago, shared on Psalm 121, a psalm that invites us to shift our gaze from ourselves to God, to find our hope and security and fulfillment in God and His kingdom, that there's a holy comfort as we shift our focus from God, for our reality to His reality. Last week, Chris led us through Psalm 122, inviting us to find our way back home through God and His word, that it's the psalm that was sung, Psalm 122, as they entered into the city. It was the psalm that the first psalm of remembrance that they had found their way to the temple, God's holy place, that they were no longer lost, but found in God and His place. And the opening psalms build this map of praise as we come closer to God and His way in the world. They lead us to joy and celebration as we journey. But as we arrive at Psalm 123, we're reminded that these road trips aren't always smooth. If you've ever been on a road trip with your family, you know exactly what I'm talking about. There are bumps in the road. There are breakdowns and conflicts along the way. So what do we do when we break down? Just like Psalm 121 invites us to shift our gaze, here the psalmist invites us to consider who God is in three different ways and how that reframes our hard times on the journey. And I have to give one brief caveat here. Today is like a 50,000 foot view of some of these ideas of who God is. There is a lot more underneath this than what I'm going to talk about today. I'm just going to give kind of a glance at who God is in these different areas. But this is what Psalm 123 says. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. Behold, as the eyes of the servant looks to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maidservant to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God, till he has mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us, for we have had more than enough of contempt. Our soul has had more than enough of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud. From the opening words of the psalm, the psalmist wants us to know a key part of the identity of who God is, that God is the king of the cosmos. Look what it says again in verse 1. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. Again, echoing Psalm 121, the psalmist lifts up his eyes. No longer is it the hills, though, that he looks to on his journey. No longer is he looking towards Zion for his hope. But now he lifts his eyes to him who is enthroned in heaven. This is actually a really important phrase, one that actually has hyperlinks all over the Bible. See, this isn't actually a statement of geography, that God somehow lives up there and we live down here, but rather a statement of cosmological importance. See, here the psalmist is making a statement about the power of God in light of a world that's filled with other powers. Earlier in Psalm 82, if you were reading the psalm, you would have immediately been drawn back to Psalm 82, where there's this dramatic scene depicting the power and glory of God. This is what it says. God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Selah. Give justice to the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They have neither knowledge nor understanding. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I said, you are gods, sons of the Most High, all of you. Nevertheless, like men, you shall die and fall like any prince. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for you shall inherit all the nations. It's this picture of God taking his seat among the divine council, of God taking his seat among the pantheon of other deities. This actually may come as a shocking statement, but Israelites never believed that God was the only power in the world. Spiritually, what we would call demons or powers of the air, people in the Old Testament would have referred to as little g gods. And in fact, the Bible never shies away from even these little g gods having power. In Exodus, we see that in the beginning of the story of the deliverance of Israel, there are actually moments in that story when the gods of Egypt have the ability by their prophets to accomplish some things. And it's at the end of the story, after the people of Israel have been delivered, that God says, I've defeated the gods of Egypt and put them in their place. The Bible is full of other stories of God defeating the other deities, or of actually the Bible throwing shade at the other gods in the area. See, the pilgrimage itself was filled with reminders of these other gods. Psalm 121, then they talk about lifting their eyes to the hills and asking, where does my help come from? They may also have been talking about all the shrines that were around the city. In fact, on all of the hills, there would have been temples to other gods that they would have had to walk through, with the different priests and priestesses crying out and saying, hey, just come worship here for a brief moment. Take a break on your journey and come worship these other gods with us. See, it wouldn't have been shocking to the ancient Near East people that there were other powers. But what was shocking is that Yahweh was king over even the gods. that he was the one that sat on the throne, that the God of Israel was unrivaled in his power over the cosmos, that all other powers and principalities in the world sit at the feet of Yahweh, that he was king of the gods, the one with ultimate power over the cosmos, the one who was enthroned on high. And this simple statement actually reframes who has power and control over the cosmos and all it contains. And this is important for us because no matter how hard the journey is, God is in control over all. God's power is over all parts of the journey. But it's important to note, too, that it certainly doesn't feel this way all of the time. This weekend, Jocelyn took the two big kids to go do something, and I was left home with Cal, who's our two-year-old, and a barking dog. And so I was trying to get the dog to stop barking, and so I turned on a show for Cal because I'm easily overwhelmed. And recently, I've found that there really is no show that entertains our two-year-old. It keeps him for about 2 seconds, and then I turn around, and he's standing on a kitchen counter. So I've been experimenting and trying to find that thing that works with him, and I finally found it this weekend, which is nature documentaries. I flipped on Planet Earth Part 2, and he was enthralled, like open mouth staring at the TV. But my favorite thing that he did, and I tried so hard to get a picture or a video of it, and I couldn't capture it, was he would put his hands on his cheeks, and he would cover his eyes, and he would go, "Oh no, oh no." And then he would gasp when something happened. And as I was reading this passage yesterday, that's all I could think about when I view the world sometimes. Like when I look at the world around me, maybe I don't do that outwardly, but I do that internally where I say, "Oh no, oh no," because we live in a world that's marked by being out of control and feeling powerless. We live in a world that's constantly fighting for our attention and affection, and it promises fulfillment and just escaping that thing. And here is where we face the question, what will you worship? Or maybe better put, what deity will you put your trust in? The word worship is defined as showing reverence and adoration for a deity or honoring it with religious rites. And it's interesting if you think about what our habits say about what we worship. On average, the normal smartphone user touches their phone about 2,500 times a day, give or take. That's on average. Sometimes it goes into the 5,000 times a day. According to Forbes, we're exposed somewhere between to 4,000 and 10,000 ads a day. Close to that. In fact, in a year, we see more ads than the previous generation would have seen in a lifetime. These ads jockey for our worship and attention, hoping to draw us into these places of worship. One of the more fascinating things to see with globalization is to the availability of other faiths and belief systems as we become more aware of what the world has to offer. And again, it seems like sometimes there's a battle taking place around us where we're almost testing the waters to see which deity will play out in the end, which gods will actually deliver on their promises. Will it be the new gods of technology or the old ones that we worship? See, politics, technology, news cycles, social media, streaming, and a whole lot of other things are constantly vying for our attention. Yet here in the opening words of the psalm, we're invited to fix our eyes, not on the powerless distractions of the chaos of the world, but on the King. The one who by his rule and reign promises that he can overcome the troubles that we face, who names that the greatest powers of the world are nothing to him. See, whatever you may face in life, remember that God is the King of the cosmos, that his power is over all things, that every storm bows to him. And even as the powers that we face feel overwhelming, and as we grasp for answers in the dark. Remember that God is the king over all things, because God is the king of the cosmos. It's a simple statement with a whole lot of layers underneath it. It's a word of comfort on its surface, but also more troubling the more you think about it. Because if he's king over everything, then it also includes the most important thing about us, ourselves. How do we engage with God? And this is where we have to come to the weird and hard part of the passage and remember this, that God is the benevolent master. This is what it says in verse 2. Behold, as the eyes of the servants look to the hand of their masters, the eyes of a maidservant look to the hand of her mistress, so the eyes look to the Lord our God till he has mercy upon us. Behold, as the eyes of the slave is actually probably how it's better translated. Look to the hand of their master, the eyes of a female slave to the hand of her mistress. As we read these verses, and as we read them earlier and we reread them again, you might feel yourself feeling pretty uncomfortable. I know I did earlier this week when I was reading this. Is this a passage glorifying slavery? Is this a passage that's an endorsement of it? Is this, why use this simile in Scripture? And certainly we have to treat this passage carefully, but we also have to not let our national shame distract us from what's actually going on here. Because the point of this is not slavery, but the power dynamics at play. Servant and slaves were told to watch the hand of their master in the ancient Near East, to anticipate the needs that they may have. Because the hand of the master was that which gave orders, provisions, punishment, and for the slave, identity. It's interesting, I've been reading a book on the Civil War. And as I've been reading the book, they've been coming at it from the perspective of politics. And one of the things that's interesting about it is they kind of talk about when they have people from the South and they read the journals of the people from the South, they talk about it like the slaves are almost like a tool, an extension of themselves. There's power dynamics at play. The master has all the power. The slave is powerless. In the relationship, the power belonged to the master, not the lowest in society. Slaves are at the whim of their masters and can only hope that they'll be treated well. But there's a difference when you look at the simile, because the invitation is to see who you look to for your power, who is actually your master. In the Old Testament, the metaphor for looking to the hand actually describes two different types of relationship. The first is the relationship between humans and each other. When it's described between humanity, it's always used to describe abusive power, of a leveling another nation, of the hand being used to punish. But when it's describing God, it's always used as a symbol of power, justice, and mercy. One is the abusive master and the other is the benevolent master. So the question for us is, which hand will you turn to? Will you look to the hand of God, trusting that he will give us mercy and love, or will we turn towards the masters of the world? They're troubling questions because we want to be the masters of ourselves. But the reality is that you will always be mastered by something. You will always worship something. Something you will always be beholden to. It's interesting. I found myself thinking about, I was listening to a podcast yesterday of an interview with a celebrity, Jason Segel. Jason Segel's been famous since he was 19 years old. He's been incredibly successful. And he was talking about how he struggled to find happiness throughout his life. And he was telling the interviewer about how he had this moment a few years ago where someone, he had written a script for a movie and they were circling back to saying he was going to be able to make it. He said, I was sitting on my orchard in Ojai, California, this beautiful property of land. I was sitting with my best friend who's not an actor, and we're talking, and I'm looking at these orange groves, and I'm looking at all that I've accomplished, and I said to him, gosh, if I make this movie, that'll show them. And he said, my friend paused for a moment and he said, Jason, at this point in our lives, who is them? It's interesting. He went on to talk about in that moment, he found that he had been mastered by a desire to prove himself. That was what was controlling him. See, we all have masters. Alan Noble, in his brilliant book, You Are Not Your Own, writes this. This is the fundamental lie of modernity, that we are our own. You may not realize it this morning, but all of us walked in this morning under the power of something. Maybe you operate from insecurity about who you are, and so you're mastered by a desire to show others your worth. Maybe you live from pride, feeling like you already know all the answers, but it's left you feeling empty with the things you can't explain. Or maybe you live out of a longing for security and are shaken by the idea that you might be out of control. See, all of us are mastered by something, and we all come shackled by those chains. And the question for us is, what type of master will we have? Are they the masters that will have our best interest in life? Are they those that will enslave and debase us? Because the masters of this world will always weigh us down. Or as Eugene Peterson observed, we live in a nation of complainers and a society of addicts. Everywhere we turn, we hear complaints. I can't spend my money the way I want. I can't spend my time the way I want. I can't be myself. I'm under the control of others all the time. And everywhere we meet the addicts, addiction to alcohol and drugs, to compulsive work habits, and to obsessive consumption. We trade masters, yet we stay enslaved. See, the masters of the world will always keep you in your place, placing weights on your head that make it hard to lift your eyes. But one key part of this is we get to choose who will master us. We can look either to the hand of oppression or to the hand of deliverance, because God is the benevolent master. See, the final word of the lament is mercy, the God who will have mercy on his people. God is not a master that does not care for his people, but rather that one that with his power seeks our good. In the journey of life, with all its difficulties and snares, we can trust that the master is benevolent and will protect us along the road, because he's not a slaver looking to exploit us, but a shepherd looking to protect us. He's the master who desires to see us live life abundantly and well, using his power for our good and love and not for his exploitative gain. Which master will you serve? See, God in his overwhelming power is a benevolent master. He cares for us even as he wields all the power, because God is not absent from our pain and suffering, but God uses his power to serve and take our place. Not because he's not just the master, but God is also the suffering servant. At the end, it says this, "Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us, for we have had more than enough of contempt. Our soul has had more than enough of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud." The end of the psalm exposes the desire of the servant to the master. Have mercy on us as we navigate a world filled with contempt. Here, the psalmist describes a picture of those who have affluence and wealth, those who live at ease, have opposed and oppressed the weak. In fact, there's a possibility that this might have been written coming out of the exile, a time when the people of God were enslaved by the different empires, the Babylonian and Persian empires, and were desiring to return back home. Those who have had mastery over them have scorned and contempt and injured their neighbor. So they turn to God, the one who is master and king with all the power to have mercy on them. And see, even as we recognize that God is king of the cosmos and also that God is the benevolent master, we also recognize that the world can be an incredibly harsh place. We live in a reality that's often not kind to us, whether it's sickness or pain or a myriad of anything else. We've been injured by others, wounds that maybe as you walked in this morning are bleeding out or still in the process of healing. The difficulties in the journey are real. And don't hear us this morning trying to just gloss over them. But that's also where we have to remember the good news of God is not that he's just standing above us in power, that we're looking up, crying out, hoping that someone distant and far off can use his power to save us, but rather that God also knows what it means to be in our shoes. Because we live out of the reality that God served us as well. When Jesus came to describe his mission, he told his disciples this, "But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man, for even I, came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Mark 10:43-45. Later on, when describing the work of Jesus, Paul exhorts the church to remember the nature of Christ, saying this, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not account equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant, and being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." See, God came to serve us as well. He did not stand far away with scorn and contempt like the other masters did, but he drew near to us. Jesus came into our situation, Emmanuel, God with us. He served and shared life with others, knowing what it meant to live, love, and even to lose. He sacrificed for us so that we could be set free. See, Jesus lived the life we could not live and died the death we could not die. And because of the servant work of Jesus, we have hope both now and in eternity that one day God will restore the world and set all things right. And as we struggle through the world, we rest in that truth and promise. Or as Walter Brueggemann puts it, "The voice of such hope grows out of urgent need, but the grounds of such hope is in the one addressed, the God of all hope, who will sooner or later turn the world to well-being, even for those whom the world holds in contempt." See, wherever you are this morning, know that God sees you. Know that hope is something that is there for you. The suffering servant sacrificed for us, so that we may have new life. This is who God is. God is the King of the cosmos. He's the benevolent master and he's the suffering servant. And we're invited on the journey to consider these things and to hold them as we walk these different hard parts of the journey. And as we do so, they invite us to ask a question of ourselves. Who am I? Who am I? See, understanding God is key to who we are. Or maybe better thought about, if we're a tree, the understanding of who God is the deep-rooted things in our soul. Whatever your roots are will reveal your fruit. And for us to understand who we are, we have to understand who God is and how it shapes what it means to live life. Alan Noble sums up this question by writing this, "Humans can't live without meaning. We must interpret our world to navigate it. The only question is where our meaning comes from." On the journey of life, you'll find many temptations to find your meaning. You'll be scoffed at for your identity, your values, and the way in the world. And to be honest, if you're going to follow Jesus, who Jesus actually is, you won't fit in a political or social camp. You won't fit in a political or social box. And the road you'll walk will be a narrow one because the way of Jesus doesn't look like anything else in the world. But the narrow road is the one that leads to life. And it all starts with asking, where will you find your meaning? Will your identity be wrapped up in fleeting fads and shifting sands? Will politics and works and kids and community and relationships and social media and sexuality be your primary identities? while these aren't necessarily bad things at their core, they will fade and ultimately let you down if they're what you have all of your hope in. They'll be like the shrines on the hills with the trinkets that don't actually help along the journey. Or will they be in the King? The one who is over the entire cosmos, the one who's the good and kind master, the one who took on the form of servant for you, the one who now calls you heir, a child of God, and invites you to walk through the hardest parts of life by his mercy. See, the road will twist and turn. Life is not easy, but when we know who we are and whose we are, we can find our way through those difficulties because our hope is anchored behind the veil in God and his kingdom, and that hope is unshakable, and that hope will guide us home. And at times you'll cry out, "Where are you, God? Who are you, God?" And he answers, "I'm the God of hope and mercy with all the power in the world, and I'm present to your journey. Will you just lift your eyes and see?" Two years after Hamburg, Jürgen was captured and taken to a Scottish prisoner of war camp. There, he was met by a lot of abuse of people that had suffered during the war that were looking for young German soldiers to take it out upon. But one day, he met a Scottish missionary who came along and gave him a Bible. And Jürgen famously once said, "I would have preferred a box of cigarettes in that camp, but he gave me a Bible, and that would do." And that was where he heard about Jesus, the suffering servant, the one that came for him, the one that loved him no matter what life had thrown at him. He later on wrote this, "I didn't find Christ, he found me. There in the Scottish prisoner of war camp, in the dark pit of my soul, Jesus sought me and found me. He came to seek and save that which was lost, and so he came to me." Jürgen Moltmann passed away this week at 98 years old as one of the most influential theologians of the modern era, writing about the nature and hope of God. He spent the rest of his life transformed by that confrontation with God as a 20-year-old in a prisoner of war camp. And he spent the rest of his days seeking for hope. Moltmann sums it up well in his famous book, The Crucified God, when he said, "The God of freedom, the true God is, not recognized by his power and glory in the history of the world, but his helplessness and his death on the scandal of the cross of Jesus." Or later on when he said, "God weeps with us so that one day we may all laugh." As he knew who God was and who he was in light of that, he was transformed. That is who God is, the one that with all the power in the world drew near to you so that you may journey home with the kind King and Master. Will you join him? Amen. Let's pray. Lord, today as we reflect on the part of the journey where we face the hardships of the world, the part of the journey where the things that we come across, the different parts of our journey that don't go to plan, the things that lead us to weep and to mourn, that lead us to cry out, "Where are you?" Lord, that you meet us there. Lord, I don't know where everyone is this morning. I barely know where I am this morning. And so, Lord, I ask that wherever we are, that you would meet us in that place. If we're in a place of sorrow and sadness, that you would meet us there. Lord, if we're in a place of joy and hope, that you would meet us there. But Lord, in those places, you would remind us of who you are and whose we are, that you call us your kids and beloved, and that you invite us to be with you. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for the ways that you have come and the ways that you saved us. We love you and we praise you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, praise Him. For for the wonders of His love. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him. Of His love, His amazing love.
For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live. Jesus is waiting, God so loved.